November 15th, 1967. In the skies over Nevada, a B-52 modified bomber is heading to a very special mission. The objective of today's flight is obviously not to drop bombs on its own nation, but to deliver another, very special payload. Strapped to its right wing is a device that certainly looks a bit like a bomb, but in fact, is the fastest crewed aircraft ever built. Yes, you heard correctly. Over here, between the fuselage of the B-52 and the engine pylon carrying engines 5 and 6, sits the X-15. In its tiny cockpit, a test pilot is patiently waiting for the launch of the experimental aircraft. Soon, the B-52 reaches its target altitude of 45,000 feet, and the X-15 is dropped. After some seconds in free fall, the powerful rocket engine of the experimental plane ignites, and the X-15's lone test pilot accelerates into the darkness of the upper atmosphere. But today's flight will not be like every other, and it will eventually end in a catastrophe. Let's find out what happened here. Welcome to airspace. First, let's take a closer look at the X-15 to better understand what this video is all about. The North American X-15 was a hypersonic, rocket-powered aircraft that was developed jointly by NASA and the US Air Force. Its maiden flight was performed in June 1959, and it would be in continuous service until December 1968. Measuring just over 50 feet or 15 meters in length, and sporting a wingspan of 22 feet and 4 inches or just 6.8 meters, it resembles a fighter jet with very stubby wings. At the back, a powerful XLR-99 rocket engine delivered thrust to the experimental aircraft. The X-15 was a vital tool for the United States in the space race of the Cold War era. During the 60s, the Americans used it to perform various scientific experiments and to gather vital information about spaceflight. During its decade of operation, the X-15 broke several records. For instance, the aircraft reached a maximum altitude of 67 miles, that is 107.8 kilometers, or a whopping 354,000 feet. According to the US definition, the edge of space commences at an altitude of 50 miles, which effectively meant that most of the X-15's pilots were astronauts in their regard. According to the international definition, the edge of space commences at the Kármán line, at an altitude of 62 miles or 100 kilometers above the ground. Only two of the X-15's pilots exceeded this altitude on their flights. To control the X-15, pilots were given not one but two flight control systems. One that used conventional flight surfaces like ailerons and elevators, but also another one that is commonly found on spacecraft, a so-called reaction control system. This system uses jets of compressed gas to control the aircraft in space, where conventional flight control surfaces are no longer effective due to the low or absent air density. What's even more impressive though is the sheer speed at which the X-15 was able to fly. On October 3, 1967, a test pilot by the name of William J. Knight took the aircraft to its limits and accelerated to Mach 6.7 at an altitude of 102,000 feet. This remains to this day the fastest speed a pilot has ever attained in an aircraft. To put that in perspective, at that speed, Knight could have flown from New York to Los Angeles in just over 28 minutes. 12 pilots, among them some famous future astronauts like Neil Armstrong, had the honor of piloting this exceptional aircraft. So, now you're familiar with the X-15. Let's go back to November 15th in 1967, where the 191st flight of the X-15 program was about to begin. In the cockpit of the small but fast aircraft was test pilot Major Michael J. Adams, age 37. He was an aviator at heart and graduated top of his class at the Air Force Test Pilot School. In 1966, he joined the X-15 program. Now, a year later, the countdown to Flight 191 had begun. The purpose of the flight of the day was to measure the solar spectrum, to collect micrometeorites, to test a new insulation for the Saturn V rocket, and several other experiments. When the countdown finally reached zero at 10:30 a.m. local time, the X-15 was dropped. A few seconds later, the powerful rocket motor ignited and propelled Adams and his aircraft higher and higher. During the X-15's ascent, an electrical disturbance occurred, which slightly degraded the flight control systems of the aircraft. Having adequate backup controls, Adams continued. After having fixed the issue, he began a planned wing rocking motion, which meant that he rolled the aircraft left and right repeatedly to allow an experimental camera to scan the horizon. At the conclusion of the wing rocking portion of the climb, the aircraft had developed a yaw angle of 15 degrees to the left, which means that the nose pointed 15 degrees to the left of the actual flight path. 40 seconds later, Adams reached a target altitude of 266,000 feet, that's 81 kilometers or 50 miles. At this point, the yaw error disappeared and the nose of the aircraft was pointed in the correct direction again, but only for a short while. After a few seconds, the yaw to the left again began to develop at an increasingly faster rate. Within 30 seconds, Adams' descending flight path was at right angles to the attitude of the aircraft, which means he descended pretty much sideways. At an altitude of 230,000 feet, 70 kilometers or 43 miles, while descending into the rapidly increasing density of the atmosphere, the X-15 entered a spin at a speed of Mach 5, that's 5 times the speed of sound. Back in the control room at NASA, there was no way to monitor the heading of the aircraft, so the situation was unknown to the engineers monitoring the flight. Normal conversation continued between the flight controller and Adams, with the controller advising Adams that he was a little bit high, but in real good shape. Adams radioed that the aircraft seemed squirrely, and moments later repeatedly told the control center that he had entered a spin. The ground controller sought to get the X-15 straightened out, but there was no recommended spin recovery technique for the X-15, and engineers knew nothing about the aircraft's supersonic spin tendencies. Spins are a vicious phenomenon in which an aircraft stalls and descends in a violent rotating motion. Exiting a spin requires great effort and skill by the pilot, especially as vertigo, acceleration and disorientation can make prudent actions very difficult. Michael Adams fought for his life with all his might. He used the conventional flight controls as well as the reaction control jets against the spin and finally, against all odds, he managed to recover from the spin at an altitude of 118,000 feet. But now, he found himself inverted, that is, upside down, and diving towards the ground at a 45 degree angle. Also, he was still hurtling towards the ground at almost 5 times the speed of sound. In theory, he was in a good position to roll the aircraft upright, pull out of the dive and set up a landing. However, he soon found himself fighting his own aircraft. The rather new flight control system of the X-15 had been configured too sensitively, amplifying all his flight control inputs in a very exaggerated way. Quickly, the aircraft developed severe oscillations along the pitch axis, or in other words, an up and down motion. As the X-15 neared 65,000 feet, it was diving at almost Mach 4 and experiencing more than 15 Gs vertically and 8 Gs laterally. The forces experienced by the pilot and the aircraft became unbearable. 10 minutes and 35 seconds after launch, the aircraft broke up over the town of Johannesburg, California. The aircraft was destroyed and Michael Adams died. After the accident, NASA and the Air Force quickly formed an accident board. Ground parties scoured the countryside looking for wreckage parts, specifically the film from the cockpit camera. The weekend after the crash, the camera was found, but the film had been ejected by the huge forces acting on the camera. Since the film was lighter than the camera, it had been carried by the wind to another location. By the end of November, the film was found and analyzed. The accident board found that the cockpit instrumentation had been functioning properly and concluded that Adams had lost control of the X-15 as a result of a combination of distraction, misinterpretation of his instrumentation display, and possible vertigo. The electrical disturbance early in the flight degraded the overall effectiveness of the aircraft's control system and further added to the pilot's workload. But in the end, it seems that Michael Adams had simply not detected that his aircraft's heading was starting to drift dangerously. Unfortunately, NASA's flight controller had been completely unaware of the developing situation. Back in the day, the X-15 transmitted telemetry data towards the ground, but this data did not contain heading or aircraft attitude data. After this crash, this deficiency was quickly rectified. A heading indicator and the so-called 8-ball attitude indicator were installed in the control center so that flight controllers could monitor the progress of the flight more closely and in real time. Also, after a recommendation made by the Accident Investigation Board, all pilots of the X-15 were screened for vertigo sensitivity. After the fatal crash, the X-15 program was continued, but only for a short while. Only 16 further flights were conducted until the program was finally discontinued in December 1968. The program had been invaluable for NASA and the US Air Force. In a decade of operation, the X-15 allowed for dozens of tests and discoveries that made modern spaceflight possible. Among these achievements were various material science breakthroughs, as well as the first application of the hypersonic theory. The X-15 also was the first aircraft to use reaction controls for attitude control in space. The test pilots also demonstrated how it was possible to transition from conventional to reaction controls. Essentially, these pilots volunteered to fly a rocket-powered aircraft to the edge of space, where they would see if the controls the engineers of the time had come up with would actually work. I really admire the courage of these men. Today, modern spaceflight still uses many of the technologies premiered on the X-15. For example, reaction jets are still commonly used in today's spacecraft, as you can see nicely here on SpaceX's Dragon capsule while it is aligning with the docking mechanism of the International Space Station. While the X-15 is a museum piece today, its achievements will live on. Thanks to the brave men who piloted these crazy rocket planes, we now know much more about space and how to get there. Michael J. Adams gave his life in the name of science and progress. He's remembered at the crash site with a small memorial that Eagle Scouts created for him. More prominently, his name appears at the Kennedy Space Center on the Space Mirror Memorial, a huge slab of black polished granite pointed towards the skies. It bears the names of all the men and women who lost their lives aboard American crewed spacecraft. Their names are illuminated in bright white on a black surface, giving them the appearance to float in the reflection of the sky. A very fitting memorial for aviators and astronauts, I think. I hope you liked my account of this tragic but fascinating story. If you did, make sure to like, subscribe, and turn on the bell icon so you won't miss any future videos. That's it, thank you very much for watching, and see you all in the next one.